We're just hanging out here, watching the comet come in. And we don't want any Heaven's Gate, Hail Bop sort of thing in the world, that is for sure. We don't want people going off the deep end, anything like that. But you can expect that probably at some point is people are going to go, some people are going to go wacko for, you know, that's, these are the very strange times, actually. Very strange times. But in the meantime, we're trying to be very sane. Now, so let's talk about some sanity here. Let's get into sanity as we wait for this comet to show up. Why not? It was clarified for me today, the Last Supper. Okay, well, Jesus is in the upper room and with the apostles, and he gives them this unleavened bread and says, Passover bread, says, here, eat this in memory of me. He gives them wine, says, drink this in memory of me. And this is my blood, and blah, blah, blah. Okay. What it was explained to me today, it just, there was a formation in my mind of clarity about this whole thing. And it's very simple, actually. Much more simple than people are making it out to be. Several things. There's some depth to it. One, what Jesus is saying about, he says, first of all, he says, gather together as if you were having a meal. But with, instead of having a meal, you're going to focus on truth and clarity. The unleavened bread means the reason of the Holy Spirit, which is very simple. It's not all puffed up like the ego. Okay, it's not like the puffy bread with all the bubbles in it. There's no bubbles in it. There's no yeast in it. It's just simple, straightforward truth. So he says, gather together as if you were going to, you know, in the past, throughout history, most people have gathered together at mealtime. Families, relatives, guests, etc. And it's a big deal. You spend a couple hours together eating the meal. So what Jesus said is, gather together at like a meal, as if it were a meal, except this meal and this gathering, you are going to focus on the simple, plain, clear voice of reason, which is the Holy Spirit, the unleavened bread. Now the wine, what is wine? It's something that you have grape juice and then you give it time. You give it time to ferment, to age, to mellow, to do what it has to do. So when you take the clarity, focus on the clarity, then drinking the wine means patience, perseverance. Let it sink in. Let it sink in. It takes time. It takes time to reach, you know, fruition, as it were. So first have the clarity, and then you let it sink in. You have patience. You don't expect immediate results from it. Okay. And he's suggesting, look, you spend a couple hours at mealtime. What I want you to do is spend a couple hours focusing on clarity. I want you to do this in memory of me. Okay. So this is a very new explanation of the Last Supper. Also, the communion wafer, this unleavened bread, okay, we have that now. And it can also represent the neutral state, the third state, neutrality, perfect neutrality. It's not all shaped and puffed up. It's flat. There's no bubbles. The Holy Spirit's wonderful state of perfect neutrality. And get to this state. Get to this state. Okay. So I would say this explains things much, much better than all this other transubstantiation stuff, which really came from Egypt, actually. If you know the history of the, you know, Egypt was very metaphysical, very much so, incredibly metaphysical, as a matter of fact. They used all this advanced metaphysical technology to try to, but alter the atomic structure of gold. And they created like heavy atoms or something like that, and they created what white gold or some sort of transmutation of atomic structure. And they thought that by eating this gold, you would change the atomic structure of your body, become eternal. And so extremely metaphysical. So actually, the Roman Catholic Church came from Egypt. It's a continuation of the Egyptian metaphysics. But Jesus, what Jesus was saying was actually very different than that. It was not a metaphysical statement. We just assume, oh, it's very metaphysical. It's not. It's not at all. The Holy Spirit is very practical and pragmatic. It's not metaphysical. So what Jesus is saying, very simple. Look, he says, look, you gather together family and friends and guests and all for a meal, and you focus on the meal, you enjoy the meal, and you spend a couple hours at it. He says, what I want you to do is gather together and have your meal be the meal of truth and clarity, and have some, you know, the food is that clarifications, okay, clarifications, explanations, clarifications, spiritual humor and lightness, and he says, that is what you need to be doing, and then the patience to let it fully develop, okay, patience of that. So where is the metaphysics there? It's not there. It's not there. It's not really there at all. Just pure pragmatism. I'm telling you that Jesus' teachings are pure pragmatism. And are we doing that? Do we spend a couple hours a day in congregation, congregating and listening to clarification? Because that's what his advice is. He also gave some advice about, he said you should consider the truth, work on this clarification the way a cow chews its cud. How's it constantly, right? Cow is constantly, even it's walking, whatever it's doing, it's chewing that cud. That's also very pragmatic. So I know that a lot of the mind, the ego, chases after metaphysics and avoids the pragmatic, the practical, what actually works. It's looking for something, you know, very metaphysical. As we wait for this comet to come in and do its thing, whatever this thing is going to be, we should be following practical advice of Jesus, actually. How many people, again, spend a couple hours a day really focused on this, intensely focused? I try to do all day. I'm taping on MP3 recorder as I drive, and then taping here, and then focusing on videos on YouTube, and just continuously trying to keep at it. Now, in the course of doing this, I've come across some techniques, and I've tried to use myself as a guinea pig for them. And I'm a little, you know, I've given them out before. I'm a little reluctant to do it, but it takes a very mature, someone who's very mature to handle the techniques. What I've said is that the ego is trying to get to yes. Yes, we can die to what we are. Yes, we can. Yes, spirit can die. Yes, spirit can die. It's trying to get there. And it's throwing up all these bubbles and complexity and, you know, just this massive diversity. And it's saying, look, 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 just there's so much activity, right? It's so much going on. Somewhere, you know, it must be happening. You know, it's happening. It's all happening. The happening. And the Holy Spirit is calmly and complete stillness and calmness. Just perfect. No. No, you can't. No, it's not possible. That's it. No bubbles. No movement. Nothing happening. There's nothing happening. We can experience that as perfect neutrality. So what we're really going toward is the no. No. No, we can't. No, we can't. Now, because the ego cannot reach this death, we cannot teach spirit how to die. We cannot die to what we are. It's impossible. God created us as we are. We cannot die to what we are. It's impossible. So what the ego hates, which undoes the ego, is absolutes. The ego can't stand absolutes. It really cannot. So as much as possible, or constantly, always try to speak in terms of absolutes. And just the ego, feel the ego just get deflated. And especially absolute no. Absolute no's. Okay, that really, it's amazing what happens. Now, you have to put this in the right context. If you cannot put it in the right context, maybe it'll backfire. I don't know. But certainly try to use absolutes. If you don't like absolute no's, just use the absolute yeses. Just use absolute yeses, but make it absolute. Because the ego always goes, no, wait a minute. Like it's the voice of reason. Wait a minute, let's not get carried away here. I mean, we're working on it. You know, we'll get there eventually, but don't, you know, it hates absolutes. We have a society, a culture, the next cycle hates absolutes. No, can't stand them. But if you can use those absolutes for yourself, and you'll find, use them in whatever way you feel like using them. For me, I'm able to handle stuff that may sound pretty severe. Like I say, no, I'll never get better. I'll never get better. I'll never succeed. I'll never feel better. I'll never, and never, 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 never. Everything that the ego tells me, oh, yes, you can. Yes, you can. He says, you can do it. You can do it. I say, no, I'm never going to. I'm never going to be free. And he thinks like, wow, how can you say that? But it rocks the ego because we're talking about the I. You see, when you constantly say, I will never, I can never, I can never. What is the I? As Ramana Maharshi said, the I is the sum total of all thoughts. All thoughts. It's the sum total of all efforts to die. So really, if you keep saying, I can never, I never, I can never, I can never, I can never, 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 never. It takes all the wind out of the sails of the I. And I find it to be fantastic. I love to hear that. When I get into that angle, it's just like a huge breath of relief come. And you just feel, oh, wow, finally, I'm getting free of the ego's incessant demand that I succeed, that the I succeeds, I succeed. Yes, you know, have to keep working, say, no, I'll never be able to succeed. I'll never be a success. I'll never be successful. I will never be successful. It's like, instead of depression, I feel the opposite. It's like lightening up. I will never succeed. Of course, I don't need to succeed. I mean, success isn't necessary for me to be what I am, or for me to accept perfect neutrality. Perfect neutrality. There's no success. There's no failure. There's nothing like that. So this is a technique the ego is not going to tell anybody. It keeps trying to push positivity on us. What I found, I feel the very best when I push pure negativity. No, I can't. No, I can't. No, I can't do it. I'll never be able to do it. I'll never be a success. And it puts suddenly a different mindset. It's like, wow. It's almost just like a miracle, actually, because you don't expect it. So embrace this no and never, 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 never. For everything. No, I'll never be happy. There's another one. I'll never be happy. I know I'll never be happy. Never. Of course, who's the I? See, I will never be happy. Speak from the standpoint of the I. I will never be happy. I will never solve my problems. I will never solve my problems. I will never get rid of anxiety. I will never get rid of anxiety. I'll never feel good. I'll never feel good. And it's like, as a very sobering but powerful kind of effect that it's sort of similar to the AA 12 steps sort of thing. What they say is I'm in the grips of a problem that I'll never be able to solve. It's beyond my power to solve it. Big release of pressure. Amazing. I'll never be able to solve the continuity problem. Never. I have a problem I'll never be able to solve. So, it's counterintuitive. You think, that's admitting defeat, and it's, I will never taste victory. I'll never taste victory. I'll never be anything but defeated. I will never be anything but defeated. And it's like, okay, huh? These are things that people never tell themselves. We're taught, don't ever say that stuff. Don't ever say it. Why? Why? Because isn't it true that the eye will always never taste victory? It'll never reach its goal, right? It's actually a true statement you're making. I will never escape destitution. There's another one. I will never escape destitution. I will never escape destitution, so. That's true, though, isn't it? The I will never escape destitution. That is true. So stop trying to help the I. State the facts about the I, and that puts you into a different state of mind. Instead of this depression, you say, well, wait a minute. I don't feel depressed about saying that. I will never escape destitution. I will never amount to anything. I will never amount to anything. Which is, it's true. The I will never amount to anything. The I will never escape vulnerability. The I will never be clear. I will never find the answer. You see, I will never find the answer. I will never, ever, ever find the answer. I will never escape time. And if you do this, you say, you know, that the I, this I doesn't seem so appealing, does it? Doesn't this I is really time. How long does neutrality take? Perfect neutrality. Does something have to happen? No. This perfect neutrality doesn't require any time at all. It doesn't require anything to change, anything to happen at all. It's right this instant. It's instantaneous. Perfect neutrality is instantaneous. So we can go from these never statements down to perfect neutrality. And we start saying true statements about neutrality. Neutrality is instantaneous. It's completely instantaneous. So as we're waiting for this, I sun is on. We wait for that. We engage in sanity, actually. So neutrality is instantaneous. Neutrality is instantaneous. So here we are, as Jesus recommended, congregating online, considering the unleavened bread, very straightforward, very simple, very clear. But you didn't, it's not fast food, there's no fast food. You came in, you sat down, you stayed. No one was in a hurry to leave. I will never understand. You say, I will never understand. I'll never get it. And then say, neutrality is instantaneous. Two facts there, right? Combine the two facts. I will never get it. Getting it is a process of succeeding, whereas neutrality is instantaneous. Neutrality, perfect neutrality, is instantaneous. It's already there. Meaning, when you think about it, you've already missed it. It's prior to thinking about it. It's quicker than thought. If you think about it, you've missed it. If you think about it, you've missed it. It's even quicker than stillness. If you're still, you've still missed it. Prior to thought, prior to stillness even. Is instantaneous. There's nothing quicker than the Holy Spirit's perfect neutrality. There's nothing quicker. So whatever we say it is, it's prior to that. Even prior to peace, prior to anything you say, prior to love, prior to everything, it's prior to that. It's instantaneous. Because all of these things, stillness, it's a concept. Love, it's a concept. It's instantaneous, prior to concepts. No matter what the concept is. Prior to the I having an experience. It's instantaneous, so how could the I be experiencing it? The I arises as a thought. Thoughts are the I, but this is instantaneous. So what can experience instantaneousness? The I can never experience it. So the I can never experience neutrality. So you say, I can never experience neutrality. I will never experience neutrality. So rather than being again depressing, I find something completely opposite. It's like, wow. Like as a breakthrough. I will never experience perfect neutrality. See, the senses react. It's prior to reacting. Thought is a reaction. It's prior to reaction. And it's neutral. Where are their reactions in neutrality? It's instantaneous. Jesus calls it the holy instant. That's a good word. The instantaneous, the perfect neutrality, wholeness, seamless wholeness of perfect neutrality, instantaneous. I can't experience perfect neutrality. You can say that. I can't experience, I'll never experience perfect neutrality. I will never experience perfect neutrality. Perfect neutrality is instantaneous. So again, we're not in a hurry to, we're like a meal in ancient times. We're, you know, savoring the whatever's brought before us. It's just like that. I mean, oh, what's this? It's a nice course. Oh, I like this. Lead some of this. Huh, this is unusual. This is a different kind of fruit. Where'd you get this? Oh, this came from Cappadocia. Oh, nice. Okay. Honey and walnut stuffed figs or something. Oh, let me try this. Oh, that's really good. And, you know, I mean, they knew how to feast in ancient times, I'm telling you. They ate way better than we did in a lot of ways, actually. I mean, they cooked a feast. They really had stuff that was delicious. What do? We throw something in the microwave. Eat some potato chips. So, these different ideas that are being given out here, they're like courses in a meal. Someone, like a buffet, you're passing around all this stuff. You say, oh, I'll try some of this. Someone serves you something. What is that? You know, nice. It's dates rolled in butter and honey and cinnamon or something. Dates, so, you know, just very delicious dates. And you're eating these dates, and oh, it's great. No hurry to leave. And sometimes the dishes you say, huh, I don't know, that's interesting. Yeah, may not be my favorite, I'm not sure, I don't really know, but okay. It's like that. So when we say something here, you just take it like it's some food being served, and you can try a bit of it. Very nice evening. The weather is supposed to turn gorgeous here. Yeah. Red sky at night, sailor's delight. The sky is having a kind of a beautiful sunset. Offshore flow is coming the next 4 days or whatever, 5 days are just supposed to be like just gorgeous. Up into the 90s. It's not really an Indian summer. Indian summer comes after the first frost. We're not anywhere close to a frost here. 48 degrees is how cold it's gotten, right? That's the coldest it's gotten. A lot of birds around here settling down for the night. I'll never find love. Say that, you know that song, I'll never love, fall in love again. It could be like any song, right? I'll never fall in love again. Say, no, I'll never find love. I'll never find what I'm looking for. I will never find what I'm looking for. I'll never find love. And rather than be a downer, it's like a great release of, like, relief. Oh, my gosh. I'm under so much pressure to find all this stuff, right? I'm under so much pressure to succeed. And you just tell yourself, I'll never succeed. And that's okay. I'll never find love. Never find anything. I'll never find anything. I'll never get what I want. This is the opposite, isn't it, of all the New Age teachings of affirmation, affirmation, affirmation. This is what I want. I want a car. I want a relationship. But I see myself receiving this relationship. I see myself getting. But who is getting? Who is getting? Who is getting it? You see? It's the opposite. Say, I'll never get what I want. So, the eye doesn't look very appealing, does it? the instantaneous, the now, the holy instant, the holy instantaneous state of neutrality is looking more and more attractive. I'll never be what I want to be. I'll never be what I want to be. Perfect neutrality is instantaneous. Perfect neutrality requires no effort. Perfect neutrality cannot be caught, cannot be seen. It's instantaneous. It itself is the seer. Perfect neutrality is the seer. It can't be seen because it's instantaneous. Perfect neutrality is the seer. Now, also, perfect neutrality is the communication between God and spirit when spirit tries to kill itself, falls into dreams, imaginary hallucinations. Perfect neutrality is God's communication with spirit. That is how God communicates with us when we're in this condition of imagining, in this training program, trying to die, and in this continuity issue that we have. What does God do? Communicates with us by this perfect neutrality. So if we want to listen to God, we accept this communication of perfect neutrality. So we can't see it. We can be seen, but we can be seen by it. It's a whole different turnaround, isn't it? We're looking for, where is this perfect neutrality? Where is it? I can't see it. I can't find it. No, it finds us. We're the one. We're being seen by it. I'll never see it. There's another one. I'll never see it. There's this bug that's been hanging around here. It's been on the camera. It's earlier, I was doing some special effects, fooling around. It was on the camera lens, and I pushed it away. I pushed it on the table. I pushed it. Now here it is, climbing the tripod. Unbelievable. This bug is still here. It's a green. It's a very green, cute little bug. It's climbing the tripod. Wow. It's just hanging out. Maybe it enjoys the satsang. The ice on the satsang as we just hang out here as ice on is whizzing its way inward towards the sun, accelerating almost exponentially. It's supposed to be going about 420,000 miles an hour around the sun. You should just make it 444, which is the number of death. It's going to be 400,000 miles an hour. That's a real slingshot. Hey, bug, the bug made it up to the top of the tripod landing. What's it going to do now? Is it going to climb the next step? It's going up there. Nice little bug. I'll never see it. I will never see it. I will never see truth. But the truth is the truth that does the seeing. And what is seen by the truth? Everything. Not just I, but the all. So the perfect neutrality sees everything. So the experience would be one of an awareness that everything is being seen. Everything is being seen. It's not our perception that's doing the seeing. It's not our body. We're not the ones doing the seeing. We think we're looking at everything we're seeing. But there's another seeing. And we're aware that everything is being seen by some other, you know, source of seeing other than our own perception. Perfect neutrality is doing the seeing, and it's instantaneous. We're being seen, everything is being seen equally. I think this is what people have referred to as God in the past. Is this, everything is being seen, but it's this perfect neutrality, it's God's communication with spirit, as when with spirit in this crisis of continuity crisis, where it refuses to set down this attempt to die to what it is. God communicates through this perfect neutrality, which is a type of perception, which is a seeing everything equally, equal vision. But we're not doing the equal vision. We are being seen as is everything, is equally being seen at the same time. You realize everything is being seen at the exact same instant. It's instantaneous everywhere. The bug is really enjoying this right now. It's just sitting right in front of me there still. Very good, bug. Maybe we should look at the bug. Let's see if we can look at the bug. I kind of disturbed a bug. There is a bug there. Okay, bug. That's good enough. Been hanging out all afternoon with me. Birds have settled down, and the birds are waiting for Ison to come on in. Now the question is Ison towing a bunch of space rock, pushing a bunch of space rock? If it's just dust in its tail, you know, okay, but, you know, what's really in this debris field is the question. That's the big question. And some have indicated, there's been a lot of foreshadowing, I'm aware of all this stuff, that it could be quite a rocky road, quite a bit of rock in this debris field, but I don't know for sure. So meanwhile, we're just doing what Jesus asked us to do, is pragmatically listen to high teaching that's outside the box. Mystics have experienced God. They say God is everywhere. God is with us. You know, they have this sense. But what is it really? It's actually the Holy Spirit's vision. Vision of neutrality, perfect neutrality, that is actually a perception of everything equal vision, as it's called, everything equally neutral. And in that light, everything, you know, it's a different perception, and it's very blissful from what the mystics say. So when people say, do you see God? Really, they probably should have said, no, it's God that's seeing me. Someone asked Ananda Maimon, do you see God? And yes, it's just everywhere. But maybe what we could say, it's more accurate to say, no, No, I don't see God, but I'm being seen by God. See, that's a different, slightly different pivot, isn't it? Everything is being seen by God. So I can speak of an eye, but not in the sense that we're used to seeing, whereas eye is the one doing the perceiving. And some things are seen, some things are not. It's different perception where everything is being seen. So there's a big eye, a big perceiver. We get the sense that there's a perceiver faster than our physical perception. Some sort of perception is taking place that is awesome. And just everything is included in it equally. And it's neutral, so you know, it's just like it. So it's kind of like the sun just sending its rays down in you know, the world like that, but it's a perception. So everything is being perceived, but we're not doing the perceiving. We are being perceived. So this is as close as I've been able to get to it as far as an explanation goes. It feels right to me. It feels good to me. I wonder about how others feel about it. Certainly explains a lot, actually. The bug kind of went into hiding there. It was like, it bothered a little bit. All that commotion, this camera going close up. Just leave me alone. I'm just wanting to listen. Come on, bug. Cute bug, all green like that. Just imagine if everything was being seen, that you didn't have to do the perception in order for it to be seen. But you're aware that it's being seen, that everything is being seen. It doesn't even need your it's not a perception that you need your sensory perception for. Everything is being seen. I would say that's the mystical experience. And then just abiding in that is the goal. I always want to take the mysticism out of everything. Get to the pragmatic. This is just a pragmatic step. We need to experience this. Abide in it. Mystics will fast. They'll dance. They'll do a sweat lodge. They'll take hallucinogens, they'll do whatever. All the fat, they'll chant, they'll fast, they'll do asanas, they'll isolation, all the stuff the mystics will do to try and, you know, get free of their own perception, as it were. Maybe just for a moment to feel like I feel a bigger perception than my own perception. But the pragmatists are simply, the pragmatists are simply looking straight at it and saying, okay, this is what it is, this is why it is. Say, okay, no problem. Don't have to do anything special. The best mystics are the pragmatists, actually. I've always shunned the shamanism, really. I'm aware of it, but I always said, that's just not for me, it's not for me. I'm more of a pragmatist. Because I grew up listening to the mystics and shamans saying, hey, yeah, I remember back there, you know, 30 years ago, I had this peak experience, and they're still talking about it 30 years later. Still trying to find it again somehow. Yeah. Well, everything was just being seen. Everything was just being seen. It wasn't me doing the seeing. Imagine it's not me doing the seeing. One minute. So we can say, I'll never be able to see. I'll never be able to see. I'll never, never, never. I never, I never. Never, never, never. I never, I never, I never. Never will be able to. I'll never be able to succeed. It's helping take the eye out of the equation, because the eye doesn't have to succeed, fortunately. We don't have to perceive it, you see? We can't perceive it. But we are perceived by it. But the important thing is everything is perceived by it. That frees us up from the eye, because the eye is the one that thinks it is supposed to be doing the perceiving, you see? It's supposed to be doing the perceiving. But now we're allowed that we are being perceived along with everything else. And it's not the eye that's doing the perceiving. So, we've had a nice meal here, a nice satsang, as we're hanging out. I'm getting called to real dinner, which is not real, but a food dinner, which is a pragmatic thing also. So at this point, I will stop the video. But most likely I'll be back at some, you know, with something else to consider. And hopefully this will, you know, precipitate a breakthrough. Maybe there's some of you out there that this will have a breakthrough. And just say, oh my gosh, it's just, I can't get it, but I'm being gotten. I can't see it, but I'm being seen. I'm being seen. We're all trying to get seen. I mean, hey, you're seeing me? You know, nobody's seeing me. But then, how about we get the sense that we are being seen? Everything is being seen. Everything has made the scene. Right? Everything has made the scene. All right, great, that's it.